Thoth Hermes podcast. Welcome to the world of the Western esoteric tradition.
Hello, friends and listeners. Welcome to episode number 14 of season 8 of the Thoth Hermes podcast. My name is Rudolf, I am your host, and today is Sunday, May 29. Welcome to this new episode in which I have the pleasure to welcome Wolf-Dieter Storl, German ethnobotanic researcher, with a big background in love and closeness to nature. Maybe a less esoteric talk today than usual, but he has also just published his part biography, because it's only a part of his life he's talking about, which he passed in America, and how the contact with nature there, with Native Americans, etc., made him the man that he is today, a man who has published a lot of books. So I'm not going to tell you more about that, more in the intro to the interview, but a very special interview with Wolf-Dieter Storl. Right, and it's my pleasure to welcome you all here in the new episode. And if you are returning customers, that's great. It's perfect to have you back again. It's great that so many of you are coming back each week to listen to this show. And for those of you who are here for the first time, welcome. It's a great pleasure to have you here. Stay with us for as long as you like, and if you missed all those over 120 episodes that have been produced so far, just go on the website, thoshermes.com, that's thoshermes.com, and you will find them all, including the show notes, and I'm stressing that every week. The show notes are a really important part of this show, of this podcast, because there you have a lot of supplementary information and many links also to those places that you would like to look up in order to get more information about the people we have as guests here. The show notes themselves, the little article that goes with them, are a bit shorter these weeks because, I'm usually very much helped by my friend Ursula to do them, but she is at the moment not available and will be back in about 2 weeks or so. And until then, bear with me, I just do not have the time to do those lengthy articles that she does so brilliantly. Right. What else is there to say? Well, you know that this podcast is supported by you, the audience, by listeners like you. And thanks to all of you who do that, who are supporters, who financially support this show, which makes it only possible. And once again, I have to say, well, please become more of you, because it's necessary. Soon, I have to say, I will start a pledge here now for, and I need a new workhorse, computer here sometime later in the year. And I will need you to support that to be able to finance it. But I will be more precise about that in a week or two. But for the time being, if you want to become a patron, please do. It's great that so many of you, well, not so many actually, but that some of you are part of that, and it would be great if many more of you would do that. It is on patreon.com. You look for the Thoth Hermes podcast and you will find us there. Or, of course, on the website where you go on the first page, on the homepage, and you find the donation button for one-off donations. And you will find the Patreon link to become a supporter, a regular supporter of this show. I also would like to remind you of Kaikobad Radio, which still has not really got its website, but Kaikobad Radio, which is the 24/7 radio internet station that I have created a month ago, which features every week 2 8-hour loops of interesting program with podcastings. Podcasts from colleagues of mine, friends of mine who do great jobs I just name a few. It's Sapere Aude's, their Occult of Personality, Glitch Bottle, and many others. So just go there and listen whenever you have time, 24/7. You just turn on, tune in to the radio. That's radio.kaikobad.com. Kaikobad spells K-E-I-K-O-B-A-D. But if you didn't have a piece of paper to write it down, just go on the Thos Hermes website and you will have on the top of the page a link to the radio station there. It's really working very well. I'm very happy with the software and everything. It's technically perfect. I just need to do more publicity work, and that's part of it, what I'm doing here now. If you were there, if you like what you heard, please tell your friends, give them the link. And if you want to post a link for Kaikobad Radio on your website, or also a player, if you want, on your website, do let me know, and I will send you the code for the player to be installed right there on your own webpage. Okay, let's play some music. Very eclectic this time again. Well, because the middle piece, the piece in the break of the interview, that is a very particular piece which I chose, which came up during the talk that I had with Wolf-Dieter Storl, that will be very classical, ancient music, actually. For a particular reason I don't want to give away. You will hear it in the interview. Why? And now, of course, because his work, Wolf-Dieter Storl's work, is very much linked to nature, also to native people, etc., I've decided to open this music program here with a powerful Native American chant, a couple chanting there. I, to be honest, can't even give you the name of the chant exactly, but I really liked it. I do think it is original. I'm, of course, not a specialist of that, and hope that is the case. If not, it's just beautiful music, right? And I hope you will like it. And we'll start right away with that Native American chant to open the talk, to open the show. And I only can tell you, enjoy. wonderful and powerful music, which I believe is a perfect lead over to the interview we're going to have with Wolf-Dieter Storl, who is my guest here on the show today. Well, Wolf-Dieter Storl, I don't know if you US listeners or North American listeners do know him that well. He is really a famous man over here in Europe, especially in the German-speaking countries. And I will also point you to his website so you can find more about him. He is an ethnobotanist. He is an anthropologist for cultural anthropologist. I think you named that in proper English. He has written many, many books in German language, but also in more and more now in English. And one of his books is a biography where he talks to us about his past as a young person when he lived in the United States with his parents who moved there. He is 80 years old now this year, and so it was shortly after World War II that they moved with him over there. He was a kid, and he learned most of what he became later on, he says, in the United States. That book is called Far Out in America, and talks about that time. A really interesting book, and I think you should read if you're interested in nature, preserving nature. And as I said already in the intro, maybe this interview today is a little less esoteric than usual, because Wolf is not a practitioner of any occult group or whatever you name it. But of course, the work he does is very, through his closeness to nature, and he really lives that, is very, to me, very esoteric as well, because it's a certain type of esotericism that we don't talk about a lot here on this show, but which is, to me, highly important. I'm also planning to do a kind of series on magical activism, let's put it that way. So, and maybe this is a kind of a starter, even there's not so much of what we call magic in it, but the way that Wolf-Dieter Storl handles things is quite magic. Well, I'm not going to tell you more. You got to discover him yourself. He's a great man, very interesting man, and I'm very happy that I could have him on the show, which was quite a treat for me, and I hope for all of you as well. Okay, so without further ado, I think we should go and meet Wolf-Dieter Storl in his native Germany, where he lives again now, well, has been living for quite some time again now, with his American wife, actually. And you will hear that he speaks an excellent, excellent English. And we are going to meet again in the break after about 34, 35 minutes. We do a little musical break, and that will be the moment when I will play for you something completely different musically than what we just heard in the beginning. I don't give it away now because it kind of developed out of the interview what we are going to hear there in the interval. So stay tuned, stay with us, and look forward to the interview with Wolf-Dieter Storl.
Here comes the interview.
Today I have a very, very special guest here on the Thought Service podcast, special in two ways, because he is a great man of ethnobotanics and of many other things, and we're going to talk about all of that in very, very short time, in a few minutes here. But it's a great moment because we extend once again in the Thought Service podcast our views on the world, not being just limited to Thelema and hermeticism, etc., but really go into other fields. But the other great moment is because he is a very, very well-known German personality, I may say. Wolf-Dieter Storl is here with us here today. And Wolf, as I may call you, it's my great pleasure to have you here with us on the Thought Service podcast. Thank you for giving us your time.
Yeah, great to be here.
Well, the occasion, actually, the actual occasion why we meet here is that you just released your, I would call it the biography of your early years. Is that a good name for it?
in English.
Say. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Well, I had written it in German because somebody asked me, well, your college years and so on must have been a typical boring time, you know, just, you know, the student life. And I said, no, it was something very special. It was the time of the 60s, the flower children and the hippies and student riots and so on. And I was right in the midst of it. And I came from a small town in Ohio near Lake Erie. It's a rural town. And I had no conception of urban life, and it was a double culture shock to go to Columbus, Ohio. That was it's the capital of Ohio, and suddenly I emerged in a world just totally like a fool or blue-eyed, as one would say, and that's what I wrote about.
Right. You were, I believe, 11 years old when your parents and you moved from Eastern Germany, what it was then, to North America, right?
It wasn't Eastern Germany. It was, I lived in Oldenburg in the British zone, but I was born in East Germany, and 1942 is a long time ago, and American troops liberated that part of Germany and Saxony, and so first contact with Americans was were American troops, and one fellow named James, he had an eye on my mother's sister, and he came visited us, and it was a time where there wasn't much food. We were starving practically, and he always brought us food and had his parents from Chicago send care packets. And I remember him playing a funny game. It was a ball that was the shape of an egg, and he threw it at me, and he said, "Hut, hut, hut." And years later, I realized it was American football.
Sure, yeah.
And then one day he came and he said, "I have bad news for you. We're moving out, and the Soviets are coming in." Mm. And then the Russians came in, and they were basically as hungry as we were, and it was a very difficult situation. At that time, my father was released from a British prisoner of war camp in a desert in Egypt, and he was afraid to go back to his hometown because the Soviets were there. Mm-hmm. And so my mother and I got into a freight train, and we went about a whole day in this freight train. It was full of people fleeing. I remember in one corner there was a man laying on the straw coughing, and my mother said, "Don't go near him. He has tuberculosis." And then near the very early in the morning, it was before sunrise, we got out of the train and we crawled in a ditch. It was all wet. It was dew. And then we made our way through some barbed wire. And I remember that because I had to go to the toilet real bad. And my mother said, "Not now, not now. Come on." I said, "But I have to." "Okay. Do you have to go big or small?" I said, "Big." And so that was my last gift to the Soviet zone of occupation. And we made it across. And I saw all these bombed out cities, you know, as a kid, very new. And then I met my father for the first time. It was 1 month before I turned 5 years old.
Wow. Yeah.
And so we spent 7 years in this northern German town. Food situation was better, but it was still it was crowded with refugees. It was a town that had not been bombed in the war because the British Secret Service was located there, and they didn't want to kill their own people. So there were 40,000, between 40,000 and 50,000 refugees there, mostly women and kids. Men were in either they had been killed or they were in prisoner of war camps. And all we kids did is play war. And that's how we got rid of the traumatization.
We
fired rocks at each other, and sometimes, it'd get hit and be bloody and so on. I mean, that's kind of how I grew up. It was a difficult time. One time I was in these huge gangs of children. I was hit by a rock right in the middle of the head and started bleeding. And I thought, oh, well, I'll go. I'm tired anyway. I'm going home. And on the way home, we lived in, the house was full of refugees. I crawled up on all fours, pretending to be a horse. And an aunt of mine, where we lived, opened the door and saw me crawling with bloody wound in the head, and she fainted.
Oh my God.
So, and I realized later she fainted. It was kind of a traumatization for her, because her only son had been killed on the last day of the war. He had not worn his helmet, and he was shot directly in the forehead. It was like, and so I was basically a little shaman at the time, bringing this to the fore once again. And then coming to America, I was 11 years old, and the opulence of it just overwhelmed us. You know, there were no fences. We kids in Massillon, Ohio, that was, and we kids played, and when we were hungry, we just go into any house. That's how it was. And refrigerator. There weren't even refrigerators in Europe at the time. It was so full. And you could just pick what you wanted. And there were always popsicles, for example, too.
Mm-hmm.
And it was compared to the dearth or the starvation in Europe, that was like coming
paradise.
Into paradise, into the land of cocaine, or Schlaraffenland, as one
Absolutely,
says.
Absolutely, yes.
Yeah,
well, this biography, it's the English version, I think, came out last year, right, in 2020.
Right.
And it's called Far Out in America. Something happened then rather soon, if I get it from your book, that changed your life into what it became later. So you made that new contact with nature at some point, right? Don't want to say discover. You find probably the better word. What happened to you that got you into contact with nature in a special way?
Well, the thing was, actually, I lost contact during that time.
Okay.
In Ohio, we moved to a very small town near Lake Erie, and I spend most of my time in nature, climbing trees, something I had done as a kid already in Europe. And what happened is when I first arrived in the small town of Spencer, kids took me to baseball playing. I never played baseball before, and they gave me the bat, and the balls just whizzed by me. And so I thought, hey, this is not no fun. That's not my game. And so I climbed over the school fence. It was a pretty high fence. And they yelled at me, hey, you're crazy. Hey, you crazy kraut. There are snakes there, and they're poisonous plants, poison ivy. And I realized something, that generally American culture divides the world into wilderness and civilization. Mm-hmm. And the whole pioneer times were the progress of civilization against wilderness. And back then it was seen that way. The Indians that were considered wild and irrational at that time,
Yes.
It has changed in the meantime. And and the wilderness had to be developed and cultivated, for example.
Mm.
And the world was divided into very Calvinistic, good and bad, sinners and saved, blacks and whites. It was back then, even Ohio was segregated. And when I went to school, the first, it was the first class that was integrated. And
oh, really?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and the very first time there were separate schools, and mm-hmm. The black kids had to sit in back, and me as a crowd had to sit back with the blacks, and the better kids, Anglo-Saxon, blah blah, they sat in front. And so I befriended mainly the black people, and in front of me was a girl. She looked, because in Europe at that time there were no black or colored people at all. She looked like a chocolate. She was made of chocolate, and her eyes were so beautiful, white, and her teeth were white. And she turned around and smiled at me all the time and gave me candies. In Europe, candies maybe at Christmas or at Easter, but it wasn't common. And so I befriended them. And some of the kids when the school pause, what do you call that?
The break, the school break.
Yeah, in the school break, mm-hmm. The white kids surrounded me, and they said, "Hey, you damn crowd, we're going to beat the shit out of you." And then the brother of this girl who had flunked about three, maybe four times, he was already real big, and he came and said, "Stay away from my friend." And so they didn't beat me up. And then he took me to the black section of town, where back then whites wouldn't go at all, to a gymnasium with a real boxing ring, and we had real gloves, and he taught me how to fight.
Okay, defend yourself.
Some of the experiences one had. And then my teacher, nice lady, she said she wanted to show me beautiful Ohio, and we'd drive through the countryside, she said. What she meant to do was to tell me that blacks are, sure, they're humans and they're good at entertainment and sports, but they're not like us, and you oughtn't spend your time with them.
Really? That was the early 50s, right?
Yeah, that was 54, in the fall mm-hmm. of 54, right. And those were some of the things I experienced, but I really didn't get into that much into social life with the others. In my free time, we played on a golf course and driving range. And the kids there, they had an old Jeep. They were allowed to drive it because it was a private property, huge area with a forest. And they had BB guns, and they played either cowboy and Indians. And I was usually the Indian.
You had a bad guy, of course.
Because I had longer hair.
Yeah, already. Okay.
I had to get shot, but I didn't mind. It was just fun for me. Get shot, or we had to play war, and I had to play German. Those are the things, and I didn't get into sports like I should have. And like I said, with the baseball, I climbed over the fence and realized I had a realm of my own. I had a realm of my own, all these trees, and I got to know the plants. I asked my teachers, what are these plants? And they say, well, they're not important. I thought, well, that's biology. You should know the plants or the names. And no, they're just weeds and scrubs. Forget it. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So I was basically not well integrated. And but I wanted to know what these plants are, because I always had a penchant for plants. So I worked in a steel mill, steel mill where they were making axles for Ford Motor Company. I worked like a son of a gun in order to save enough money to study. And then the botanical studies were very disappointing. And so I quit that. I had never slept in a huge cement dormitory, 50 kids. students per, only male. It was back then male and females could not cohabit together. 50 per...
per room or per dormitory.
Level, And three in a room, and I couldn't sleep there. So I went out and slept outside. There's a woods near the campus. Scioto River flew there, flowed by there. And and until winter started and was too cold. So you see, I was not really that well integrated.
Yeah.
But what happened is I got sucked into this academic thing after a while, and I kind of lost my contact to nature. And that came back sometime later then.
But it must have been something that called you already at that time, because you say you lost it. I understand what you mean by the official way of the mainstream life that you led, right? But how did you find it again? I mean, there must have been something in you that attracted you so strongly that drove you back, no?
Yeah, always. I think, I can become a little metaphysical here. I think it is, I think I've spent quite a bit of time in India, 2 years and then other visits, and I came to realize that it is very possible that we come again into life. I mean, there's such a thing as rebirth, and what we, when we come back, we bring our old karma with us. It doesn't stop.
You know, certain knowledge that you attained there, right?
Certain knowledge, certain tendencies, that makes the purpose of this life now is the old karma, things that we have to say to make up, things to better, stuff that we own. Other people and so on. And that tells us the old karma gives us that which we are supposed to be doing in this life. That's what I, we come in back into life. And we are gifted. We know that in our own culture also, that we come from this is all metaphysical, come from the highest level, from the archetypes of, they located it in the Renaissance, in the in the realm of the fixed stars. And then we come down the planetary, steps. And first we come from the fixed stars and go through the gate of Saturn, and then we come closer and come to Jupiter and then Mars, and then we go to the door of the sun and go Venus and Mercury, and then the moon, and then we are fully incarnated. That it takes that to incarnate. And each of the planets, so the Renaissance idea, each of the planets give us gifts that we need for our life. So we can do the karma, the dharma, maybe, that we are supposed to do. Yeah. And most of us don't remember that, and the gifts that we have in us lay fallow. And then one of the tasks is for us to find what we really have to do and what we want to do in life. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, it's just kind of, we have jobs and we never have a real calling then. And so in the modern times, much of the youth spends the time just searching for why am I here? What's the purpose of it all? But there is a purpose based on old karma. So this is what how I explain my connection to the plants. Mm-hmm. It is so deep. It goes beyond the inputs or of this life.
May I ask you something, just a little intermediate question before we come back to your personal calling? You just mentioned the youth today and how they have difficulty to find their way. Do you think that modern times, as we live them nowadays, make it more difficult to the young people to find that calling, or is it just because they don't look for it enough? What, in your opinion, is that exterior to the person or interior to the person, that difficulty?
I think it is that we are misguided very often. In olden days, even in the Middle Ages, when you had an agrarian society, there was such a thing as a family or a group, karma or dharma. Mm. So that a kid who was born as a son of or daughter of a miller would become a miller, and a farmer, a peasant would become a peasant, and so on. But these days, that is not so. And we have so many voices speaking and so many distractions. And the distractions, it begins with the already with kindergarten, and nowadays with the electronic media that we have. And I mean, when you think 12 years of indoctrination, that is pretty heavy to get out of there and really find your true way.
Certainly.
And often I think that's one of the reasons why young people often go for some kind of drug experiences to test their limits, to find out, hey, where am I? What am I doing?
Yeah.
And that's, and in traditional societies, that is possible. That is, those are initiation rites. And traditionally, in many societies in Africa, Asia, and even here in Europe, it used to be that the boys, when they were just coming into puberty, mm-hmm. were separated from their mothers, so to say.
Yeah.
And go into the woods, often traumatized, and then the elders would teach them and help them find a way. We don't really have that. Sometimes for a while it was the military. I remember in Ohio in the 50s, you became a man after you'd been in the military.
Right.
And basically, that's when you're capable of marrying and having a family. But all that is has kind of disappeared. And so people have a hard time, young people have a hard time finding their way. And also traditional roles have gone away. I'm not saying that that was better, but it was different. And it is not easy for young people. It's these days, it's very easy to be led on to a kind of a false path.
Yeah. Well, initiation, the word says it itself. It's the beginning of something. So, and that's maybe what's missing. You just mentioned then, well, the drug scene, etc., which of course is often misleading. The time that you spent as a young man, so to speak, in the US was, of course, especially there at the time, a time when the psychedelic 60s, etc., that was a very strong moment. How was your experience with that?
Well, the whole time, that's what I'm talking about in that book, Far Out in America, was basically an initiation process.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, I was, separated from the traditional Midwestern German way of thinking. Already started with religion. Yeah, I was, in a Christian church, and I believed everything. And then you get a psychology professor who says, well, Jesus was a faggot and all his disciples were that. And man, that's a shock. And then on Good Friday, well, you had classes. It was not a day of meditating or whatever. Mm-hmm. And on that day, we had to dissect frogs in a biology class. And I love these little frogs, and I couldn't do it. And that on Good Friday, it's like actually the suffering of Christ in the form of a little frog.
Yeah.
You're just kind of blown open and blown away. And so I had this all karmic. I think I had a very good friend came from Cleveland, and he had a friend who had gone to Harvard, studied psychology by a certain professor named Timothy Leary.
Oh,
yeah, and he sent a letter, and he said, "We're doing fantastic psychological experiments, and here's a little powder. It was LSD in milk sugar, I guess. And put it in your coffee or your drink, and write us what happened." Well, I saw the letter, I read it, and I took this powder and went off to my classes. It was an English literature class. And there, and something strange started happening. While waiting for the class to begin, I noticed people were just talking and just to pass time. It had no meaning. The words just became like drunk, out cans of Coca-Cola or something, then the bell rang, and the guy I'd been standing next to says, "Come on, our class starts." And I said, "Well, I'm not a Pavlovian dog who's going to jump when the bell rings." He didn't understand what I was saying. So I went outside and met this hillbilly girl that I had befriended as a wild young thing. And she says, "Oh, there's some European movies right here in the university hall." Yeah, it was a movie with Alain Delon, a French movie.
Yeah, sure.
Well, what was there were typical intellectuals, thick glasses and beards and stuff. The artsy, craftsy types. And I went in, and it really started hitting me. And I saw, on one hand, I saw just a display of light on the screen.
That
on
another LSD coming through you.
It was coming through, right?
Yeah,
and
yeah.
Then at the same time, it was actual consciousness expansion. At the same time, I could see on the screen how the actors were trying more or less successfully to mimic human behavior. And then I saw the level on which the plot went, where everybody was stuck on. And when there's sad scenes, you heard people and maybe even getting a tear rolling down the eye, the cheek, and so on. And it was just multifaceted. I could tell Alain Delon, he had a hangover while he was playing some of the scenes, and he had smoked too many cigarettes. At the same time, I could sense it was still late February, the cold wind. It was stopped by the building, but the essence went through the walls. And it was such a fantastic experience. And then suddenly, the light went on, and the screen went silent, and I thought, wow. And my girlfriend said, "Come on, what's the matter with you? Why are you sitting there?" And I didn't want any fight with her, so I did. I should have kept sitting there in kind of entrance. Well, I went out with her. It's cold February wind. I sat down on a sidewalk, and I realized that I was beyond time in something you call eternity, and that time is a fiction. And I told people passing by, "Time has stopped. Isn't it wonderful? Time is not real." And a crazy sitting on a cold sidewalk. and a professor whose class I had skipped, he came, he happened to go by and saw me, and he says, "Are you all right?" I says, "Wonderful." I was like in a Buddha state. A few days later, he wrote me a letter saying, "I don't know what problems you have, but stay at the university because you have a lot to give." And then as I sat there, I felt my soul was way up in the sky, and a voice said, "Now you have seen a mystery, and now you can come down back to Earth." And I had never had such an experience. There was no psychedelic culture at the time.
Sure.
Nobody knew what LSD was or anything.
Yeah.
And it was months later than we, my best friend and I, we ordered some more of this magic stuff, and it really helped expand the soul. And I'm glad that was before there was an LSD culture, before there were experts and psychologists and pastors and sociologists who would explain the experience and already bring it back and guide it.
And narrow the possibility by
it. And narrow it. Even psychedelic rock, which is really wonderful, narrows the experience. And so I think in that way, LSD as a substance, a substance of mystery, is gone. It was only at a certain time that it opened doors. So, I mean, you know, if you're stupid and you take LSD, you're not going to be any smarter.
Yeah, sure.
Or if you're a criminal, you're not going to be suddenly a good guy. I mean, it's that kind of stuff.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, that was part of the,
Is that kind of explanation that you give for that experience, is that also true for other types of, can call them mystical or mind-expanding experiences, that at the moment where you start explaining them too much, that they narrow down and you can't
repeat them? Exactly. Yeah, I think that is so. Hmm. Even when coffee appeared in the early days of enlightenment, you know, the ancien regime, the kings and princes and so on, well, they were on alcohol, wine, and common people on beer and milk and so on. Mm. And coffee created a mental revolution. And people, just a cup of coffee, took on psychedelic dimensions. And only in that way is Johann Sebastian Bach's cantatas to be explained. He was in coffee. Yeah. And Ludwig von Beethoven had the first espresso machine.
Really?
And he counted the beans, coffee beans per cup. And I think it was 66. He counted exactly that. And then he got into this creative rush. Nowadays, well, most people just drink coffee and it doesn't do that much.
There is the famous coffee cantata by Bach, actually. But
right.
I didn't see, I mean, I'm a musician professionally, but I'd never seen the background to that.
Yes. That's what it is. He is, the time, you could express your art mainly in the confines of what the church allowed. So it's mostly by Bach, that's also the influence of coffee. By Bach, it was the love of the soul to Jesus and to God. They were lovers. And it was a different kind of Christian religion because of coffee. And the only other thing besides religious subjects, he praised coffee. Oh, how sweet coffee is. It's sweeter than 1,000 kisses. If you love me, give me a maca, a coffee.
Okay, let's stop here for a moment, because you just heard that Wolf, he really likes coffee. And he was mentioning that because of this coffee cantata by Johann Sebastian Bach. Well, I told you, the music this week is very eclectic, very diverse. Now we're going to hear Johann Sebastian Bach. And, well, we will hear, of course, that little aria from that cantata, the coffee cantata it is called, where this young woman sings all her love for coffee, which is stronger than anything she desires. But that's part of the later part of the cantata. We only hear the aria with the coffee topic. After that, we'll return to Wolf and continue our discussion with Wolf-Dieter Storl on his life in the Americas, on ethnobotanics, etc., etc. Very interesting topics. And at the end of the interview, we hear a third piece of music, which is called The White Feather, which is, well, it's not, it's inspired by North American native music, but it's, of course, not. It's the typical kind of revival music that we often hear, a very nice one, the Wise Feather. After which I will return with announcements for next week's episode. So stay tuned. Now, before we return to Wolf-Dieter Storl, we're going to hear the excerpt from the Coffee-Cantata, that great aria about coffee. And afterwards, the White Feather, and we'll close with my announcements. Enjoy. Well, that story of the coffee brings us, of course, back to ethnobotanics, because I mean, it's a plant in the end, right? Tell us, you said you felt that special relationship to the world of nature, the plants, the trees, etc., which goes beyond what you can explain, probably even. But how did you from that become first a professional ethnobotanics? And what exactly would you name, how would you describe ethnobotanics? It's a term maybe that needs a bit of explanation.
Right. Ethno means people, and botanic is plants. What it is I was, after the disappointment with botany, and I'm glad I quit it, because that would have cut me off, put a barrier between me and the essentials of a plant. Mm-hmm. And so I went into anthropology, which is, anthropology is ethnography, prehistory, linguistics, and anything that has to do.
That was still North America, right?
That was in North America where I discovered anthropology.
Yes, because is it true that anthropology is also in a different way defined in North America than in study than in Europe? I think
it is. It is. Right. It is called anthropology, and it includes all these other facets.
Even archaeology,
ethnography, so on. Yeah, yeah. Whereas in Europe, it is separated. You have physical anthropology. You have primatology, you have ethnography, you have linguistics, and so on, separate. But in America, you have kind of like an overview.
Yeah. Yes.
And I noticed with most of the ethnographic reports, they were very, very good at social relations, familiar relations, social structure, cooking and hunting techniques and so on, but very, very few. There was very little mention of plants. And so I was interested in that. How does a culture, how does it deal with the plants? And it is, and most anthropologists are not botanists, so they ignored that. Mm-hmm. It is just like ethnomusicology. Most are not into music or have no training at all. Mm. But later on, when I was at the University of Vienna, I realized there was a whole department of music ethnology.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm. And and if you want to know about different kinds of cooking and so on, well, French anthropology, starting with Claude Lévi-Strauss, is excellent when you want to hear about how people cook and how they go along with food.
Funny,
it's that too is each culture
cultural
has
differences.
It's
sure,
opus. German and Austrian anthropology is very open to music, for example.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm,
yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And so I started becoming ever more interested in how a society relates to plants, what plants mean in a society. And all that was, that was not common in this study. And I went into that. I got acquainted with and sort of personal friendships with the Cheyenne Indians. And I was a good friend of a Cheyenne medicine man, a very well-known good medicine man, Bill Tallbull was his name. And his life purpose was to be an ambassador to the green folk, to the plants.
Okay.
And he got that. Every young person in most American Indian cultures, they go in their youth into on vision quest.
Yeah.
Where they're also like
the initiation, basically, also,
it is,
right?
Basically the initiation. And, you'd sit there 4 days minimum. In some cultures, the Chippewa, it's maybe 7 days, but 4 days, and you don't eat, you don't have a fire, you sit in the wilderness, you don't, I mean, you hardly drink anything at all. And yeah, we would say from an external point of view, well, as glucose deficiency in the brain and you start hallucinating. Mm-hmm. But the thing is, the soul leaves the body confines and comes into contact with the beings in nature surrounding. Mm-hmm. And while he was sitting there, a coyote appeared. And you can just see coyotes, sees there's animals, coyotes, dogs, and so on. They can sense the brain vibrations or the vibrations of the people. And he was probably in a kind of meditative, I think it's alpha state. Mm-hmm. And so he came by and he started communicating. On this other level, the humans and animals can communicate, can talk to each other. And the coyote said to him, you come from the dog soldiers, but you're not going to be a warrior and you're not going to be a hunter. Your purpose in life is to be an ambassador for the plants. And right. So he became the plant expert of the Cheyenne and the master of healing herbs. Mm-hmm. And it's on that level I met him, or on that level we became very good friends. And for a year and a half, I, not all the time, but like every weekend, we'd go into the wilderness and we'd meditate into plants, and we opened ourselves to the spirits. And I noticed while I started botanizing, counting the stamens and leaves and so on, and of the plant, he just kind of looked at me. Hey, what's that crazy weho, this white man doing? And I noticed he talked with the plants. And there are some plants he did not talk with. They were not friends of the Cheyenne, as he said.
Okay.
And so it took me a long time to realized what he was doing, to how would you say it, to connect, to clink into his way of seeing the
thinking.
World. And it was not just, it was more than thinking, it's just opening your being.
Right.
And this is what one of the wonderful things he taught me. He taught me to see the plants as very powerful, in his words, magical beings who incarnate physically and are alive, but their soul and their spirit is around them. They are not ensouled, they are surrounded by soul.
Yeah.
And when their soul, when their specific soul, group soul that is, touches the physical body, then a great metamorphosis happens. The plants start to flower and they get soul qualities. They get colors which speak to our souls, right, and to the souls of bees and other animals. And they get fragrance. They start smelling good, which works very deep into our feelings and into our souls. And their whole metabolism basically changes and becomes a little more animal-like. The plant is where the flower is where the plant touches the sphere of ensoulment or astrality, as one would say here.
Exactly.
And that is the bridge between the two. And all that made sense. Later on, I quit university and I was in Vienna and I stumbled upon a community in Switzerland that was a biodynamic community.
I was going to say, because your terminology you just used with the was a bit Rudolf Steiner's terminology.
For me that was very important. I went to this biodynamics and suddenly there was Rudolf Steiner, whom I've known in the literature, as some kook who believes in Atlantis or in something. And then I noticed in biodynamics, they're really in touch with the soil and with the plants and the animals. And they had a special vocabulary that did not limit it, like the official science to what you can weigh and what you can analyze, but it takes in a non-physical dimension. And I found that is very similar to what the Indians, the American Indians, native people there, knew. And Steiner gave me, or the work with biodynamics, gave me a vocabulary, because otherwise I did not have a vocabulary. It was like in school, back in high school and junior high, nobody could tell me what the plants were like. And then later on, when you know the names, you kind of got a grip on.
Yeah.
Words are very important, and I'm very thankful to Steiner for that.
It's like a professional terminology in a way for that
right,
field, right?
Right, right. For that which is there, but not physically tangible.
Yeah.
It's just like words, you know, they're not material things that are passing between us right now.
Yeah.
It's a sort of really talking sort of a spiritual
astral, I think Steiner would call it, yes. Mm-hmm. May I go a little bit back to the North American, the Indian, the medicine man, and the other probably Native Americans that you met? That, of course, makes me think about shamanism. And you mentioned that very briefly in the very beginning when you crawled, like when you brought that experience to your aunt. But shamanism, I know in one of your books, you also relate to Celtic shamanism and to Nordic shamanism. Of course, one says the origin of shamanism is in the Far East, in Siberia or wherever, but that's all theories. What were your, or did you make any personal experiences with that world? And what's your view on that, also in relation to animals and plants?
Yeah, I mean, I had these experiences as a school kid, because I spent most of the time in the woods, and I realized when I went to college that they had no understanding of plants and animals. They had them in laboratories, and I thought it was just terrible what they did to them. And the agricultural plots, experimental plots they had with plants. And I could see these plants were very unhappy. And I couldn't tell my professors that plants can be unhappy. Well, they have no brains. They have no soul. How can you say that? But they were unhappy. And I think all of us have basically shamanic abilities. Every one of us, but they are overlaid, they are covered by all kinds of the ideas we have, by the programs we take in every day through television, by the novels we read. That's like basically trash, and it prohibits us from really communicating. And if I can say something more about shamanism,
please, yes.
Officially, shamanism is from the Far East, but we know enough that there was a universal Paleolithic culture stretching from Western Europe all the way through Asia into the Himalayas, Mongolia, Siberia, into the New World, because the Native Americans came from Eastern Asia, mainly from the area around Baikal, which is the center of shamanism, where you find these large drums, round drums, and similar shamanic customs and initiations and so forth. So there is a universal basis for shamanism on other continents, in Australia or in Africa. Some anthropologists say, well, they don't really have shamanism. Yes, they have their way often with shamanic aspects, to communicate with the non-incorporate beings, spirits, and so on. So, talk about European shamanism. One always hears about Celtic shamanism. Well, basically, more important were the Druids, who had shamanic abilities, but were ritual leaders and keepers of the tradition, the oral tradition, and masters of magic. More shamanic were the Germanic tribes and the Slavic tribes. Germanic tribes had their main god was, like the Vikings and the Anglo-Saxons and the Frisians and so on, their main god was a shaman god. And that was in Nordic, Odin. In Anglo-Saxon, Woden. In German, Wodan, and so on. And the thing is, he was one who did not let any border stop him. He was a transgressor. He could go to the world of the dead. He could travel on his eight-legged white horse. White is a color of spirits, but eight legs, what is that? That is actually is the ones who carry the beer, the pallbearers, the ones that carry the dead, you know. And when the corpse lies there and is brought to its last rest, it's like they're riding a horse with eight legs.
Eight legs.
And it is in the, I think it's in the Eddas, it talks about Sleipnir, the slow sliding horse.
Sleipnir,
That it talks about it, that Odin lay there as though he were dead, is on shamanic travels.
Traveled and trance,
trance. And then in the spirit world, he could, which is true of all shamans, he could take on the form of a bear, a wolf, a raven, an eagle, a snake. He saved the the famous brew of initiation in the form of a snake. He went into the castle of these demons or giants, and he seduced the daughter of the... he changed himself into a beautiful young man. Spent 3 days in utter love ecstasy. And she says, so what can I do for you? He says, let me have one swig, just one swallow of this magical brew. And she says, oh no, my father would be very mad. He says, you have just one swallow. And then she granted him that, and he took the whole elixir ambrosia into himself and changed into an eagle and flew away. And that's how the gods got the drink of inspiration and not the demons.
I mean, right. That reminds a bit of Zeus, Zeus, almost, right? Who also changed into animal bodies.
Of course, that's another Indo-European god, Zeus. See, the word comes from Deus, is god. And Deus Pita is Jupiter. I mean, they all have... these have Indo-European roots, these gods.
Yeah,
but especially Odin is a shaman's god. And he has all the qualities of a shaman. He is shape-shifting and tricky. And the common people liked Thor or Thunar in English and Donar in German better because he was steady. He was like a good, strong, you could trust his word, but you couldn't trust the word of Odin.
Sure not. Have you personally, if I may ask, have you personally made shamanistic experiences in shamanistic travel and trance? Have you participated?
Yeah, I have. I've had these experiences, and especially in in nature when I walked around in the Rocky Mountains, and then later on as a gardener, in biodynamic gardener, you'd get up with the sun in the summer at 4:30, and you'd be in touch with nature, with the plants and so on all day long. And often when full moon came, we made gardeners and friends made a fire, and it was as if the spirits got into us. And so and we danced like one couldn't really normally dance, because not what you learn in dance school or something. And they were and we got into a state of ecstasy where you could feel, and at certain times practically see, the spirits. For me, mm-hmm. that was biodynamic. That was a dynamic side.
Right.
The village priest thought it was revival of heathenism, and yeah. he was very afraid, and he tried to stop that. And
I'm sure.
Yeah, yeah. No,
it's a kind of an animist approach, right?
Yeah, yeah. Animist in a sense. That's a early anthropological term. They would have liked to use Edward Taylor. He was a famous British anthropologist. Mm. And he said, yeah, the primitive people, they believe in spirits, and everything has life and has spirit. He wanted to call it spiritualism, but there was already a cult called yeah. spiritualist. So he called it animism, from anima, right. soul. Mm. And what he said, primitive mentality only sees everything as everything being ensouled, everything having a soul and can be spoken to. Ha, how primitive. Le mentalité primitive. Huh?
Yes, exactly.
And, and then with the idea of progress, then came the state of barbarians who had, where not everything was alive, but they had multitudes of gods, polytheists. But the really modern, enlightened people have only one god, monotheism.
And so they can kill each other for the one god.
Yeah, that's about it.
I want to come back to that sentence you said in the beginning when you left baseball, so to speak, because you found out, you said that people divide the world into the good, positive, developed part and the natural part, which is bad, just right. to say it very bluntly. How do you see that in 2022? I mean, not you personally. I think I know what you think. I hope. But how do you see the world? Has that point of view changed? Is it become
I don't
worse
think so.
Or?
Unfortunately, not. When you look at current politics, I think, attempts are being made, but much of that is mental, because most people, they've gone through years of schooling and they're stuck on the mass media, and they get programmed in a certain way. And there's a lot of, and it is what they're thinking or what they are feeling is basically an intellectual idea. It doesn't come mm-hmm. so much from the heart or from the guts.
Well, and from the spirit, in the sense of Geist, from right. Yeah. And what do you, I mean, a young person who reads your books and who tries to follow a path that could do good for his own development and then for nature. What would you counsel somebody in 2022 who came up to you and say, yeah. well, Mr. Storl, tell me, I would like to improve. How can I do that?
I get that all the time. And what I tell sure. them is, and that's part of the Central European tradition of Goethe and Schiller, who had another approach to nature. And it was viewing, being in nature, how would you say that?
It's a romantic view, right?
Yeah, romantic view. Yeah. It's not this dividing. And what I tell them, in a world with so much virtual reality and all kinds of things that will tie you mentally, the best thing is to go back to the source. Go to nature. Walk barefoot and you'll just defeat the souls of I don't know how many nerve endings to communicate with and receive information from the earth. It's real different walking on grass than walking on mud or whatever, or on cement. And the earth speaks to you. And then take time, very consciously take time in the rush of things. Just stop. And look at that little flower that's growing there in a crack in the wall or as a weed, and stop and look at it. Go into it. Not just you say, oh, well, that's a dandelion. I know it. You don't have to look at it anymore. Realize you've never seen this dandelion before. It's a magic moment. It's a one time, soon a dandelion will be gone and so on. And smell it. Use all your senses. Use your smell. Mm-hmm. At the same time, use your ears. What birds are singing. And then go into this moment that is a door to timeless eternity. And this is what refreshes our soul and gives it strength. And then of course, you know, you can't constantly do that forever, because you'll end up in a loony bin. but you have this, I call it a Zen moment, like Zen meditation. You fully connect, and then you'll go back into the normal business of modern, the rush of modern life. Or just when you have an office job at lunchtime, take the time to look at a flower, or just stand there and feel the sun. Feel the sun on your face and on your hands. This gives you strength. And what I tell young people is always connect with these sources. That connects us with our ancient ancestors back into the pre-Stone Age. That is basically our home.
Yeah. And how do you do that? Also through the contact with nature and plants?
Because our way, way back ancestors were in constant contact. I've seen that with Stolbel and the Cheyenne. They're constantly open. They're not very successful in schools, except a few. But they sit there in a school and they let the words go in one ear and out the other. And they don't like to read. Tobel could read. He was one of the very few. But they don't like to read because you're putting paper and ideas between you and the phenomenon. And for them, the phenomenon is, the direct appearance of nature is the most important. Mm. And we're living in a world where I see that all the time with herbalists and so on. They've learned their herbalism mainly in books and in the internet, and it stays pretty much in the head. But sometimes I let my students just crawl on the lawn or on the forest floor and sniff. I tell them do it like dogs, not. Sniffing, the olfactory nerves can relax and you can smell a lot more, and you realize what a bouquet of scents there are on the ground. Okay. How wonderful. A lawn smell. Just, of course, if you're worried about your neighbors looking and seeing you crawl and sniffing in the lawn, and let them walk barefoot and so on. I mean, even in a city.
But it's interesting what you say, because those the teachings or that way of doing things is something that magical schools, you know, when you teach magic in the classical way, also ask for in the beginning in order to get to know your surroundings. You have to walk barefoot, you have to start to use all your senses, get them more used to what you do. And it is certainly very much related, right?
Right. Well, magical schools are like an extension or sophistication of basic shamanic abilities. Yeah,
exactly. With the same problem that at some level people read too much and don't practice enough.
Yeah, that's. It depends on the motive. If it is to gain power, then you can get yourself out on a limb. I've basically avoided these magical circles because I've seen shortcomings, and you don't really need it, because nature, if you get into it, is magical anyway.
Yeah,
and every person's life can be magical. Because like Ernst Jünger, he was a famous writer, said, if you don't believe in miracles, you're not a realist.
That's a good one. Yes, that's a real good one. Right. Well, Wolf, we are coming towards the end of our talk, I'm afraid. This was fascinating. And thank you for all your input and all your knowledge and wisdom that you shared with us. We talked a little bit about America, but of course we want people also to get that book and read it, because it's really fascinating. There's many, many stories which are very meaningful in detail. So we couldn't even have talked about all of them. But I'd like to ask you for a kind of a final word. We live, as you also mentioned, in a time that's a bit strange and a bit difficult at the moment. And people are looking for meaning all over the place. Can you maybe give those a little bit of a good thinking on their way, how they can look for the future in another way?
Yeah, I think there is no schooling, no system, no ideology that can give you can give you what you need. Only yourself. If you're centered in yourself, then all the stuff is like the eye of a hurricane, you can say. That can be our being in our microcosm, or the North Star. All the other stars revolve around it. That's of course, astronomers will say, well, that's total BS. But for 100,000 years, humans and animals and we and the shamans have seen that. That's the only star that doesn't move.
It and anchored us, yeah.
It
yeah,
anchors, yeah, and we have this anchor in us. Mm-hmm. And when we find that, then we can, and that's very important for shamans, they have to be anchored, they have to be centered in themselves, then they can go way, way out. Other people, like good church people, it is the church that gives them, has fences, beyond which you're not allowed to go.
Can't fall down by the edge.
That's why the church has defined people as sheep with a good shepherd who guides them through this life to the other shore. Well, shamans are not into that. They are their own shepherd. They have to be centered. If they're not centered and go way out there, they can go get lost in demonic dimensions, become themselves demonic and think they're wonderful, or they can basically lose themselves. You have to be centered. Yeah. That's the thing.
Yeah. So try to be centered, and that's, I think, the message. Wolf-Dieter Storl, Wolf, thank you so much, and good continuation, and thanks for all that, what you gave us here today.
Yeah, well, thank you for letting me speak, because what else should I do in life these
absolutely.
Days?
Absolutely. Continue. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
The White Feather by a musician called Ahni Ma. I hope I pronounced that properly. The White Feather closed our episode for this week. Well, almost. And because before we leave each other now, I want to thank first Wolf-Dieter Storl for having accepted to appear on my podcast. I was very pleased and honored to have him here on the show this week. And I have to thank all of you for listening and coming back each week. It's really great how many people are coming to us next week again, hopefully. And next week, it will be episode number 15 already of this season 8. And Mary Kay Greer will be my guest. And we will talk a lot about the tarot, but also, and that was initially also one of the ideas why I got her on the show, about her book, which is already 27 years old, believe it or not, on the women of the Golden Dawn. So we talk about women, occultism, about the Golden Dawn, and of course, when you talk to Mary Greer, we talk about the tarot. So for the time being, I hope you enjoyed this week's show, and have a good week, have a nice week, have a safe week. Take care. Stay tuned. Hear you soon.